On the day I announced my impending retirement as a teacher of retarded adults, I promised my students that I would make a movie with them. For 2 years, I had woken at 6:30 in the morning for my hour-long commute to the school and my daily appointment with Group 10. After arriving home at 6 p.m., I would need to listen to an hour of Bach in order to readjust myself to the world of the developmentally abled. Notwithstanding the taxing schedule, it was the only job I've held in my life that I really liked. And when the alarm rang, I was actually anxious to get started. But as we all know, circumstances change faster than the human heart, and I had given tailwind to circumstances by amassing severe gambling debts, which required I accept a position at a small college about 100 miles from New York City and my pursuers. My students were upset whenever they were reminded that the day of my departure was soon at hand, but seemed to calm when we worked on our film. I assigned them each to imagine what it would be like if we all took a trip to the countryside where I was going to work. They then made paper or clay figures that we would animate together as I shot frame by frame with my Super 8 camera. As enthusiastic as they were about creating the set for the film, only Mario was truly interested in looking through the camera lens. He didn't just look. He would walk around the classroom with the camera attached to his eye until I convinced him the show would not go on until he gave it back to me. Mario Caniero Jr. was born in 1952. All medical reports showed him to be of normal intelligence until he suffered an accident at the age of 4. Mario had never been one of my favorite students. In fact, he irritated me. He repeated himself endlessly, affixing my name to the back of his sentences like the camera to his eye. All those sentences, variations on the theme, "I'm not happy." The last was the worst. This meant he had a stomachache. Someone was hurting him in the stomach, and if that person didn't stop, Mario was going to become very angry. And when Mario was angry, he would begin to hit back. But he may as well have been beating his head against a pillow, as we were not allowed to restrain or even touch a student who was acting out. And there was no satisfaction in that for Mario. My instructions were to evacuate the room, close the door, and wait until Mario had finished breaking all he must have felt he needed to break. I would then cautiously re-enter the room, where I would find him curled in a little ball. I also took pictures of all my students, which they were assigned to make into collages of themselves. When Mario saw his photos, he said, "Of course I do." "Why do you say that?" "What do you mean?" He was right. He irritated me. On the day of the big snowstorm of 1987, Mario had his face plastered against the window, his eyes shifting to and fro as if chasing the storm. I gave him the camera to take outside. I watched through the window as he tracked the snowflakes, waving his camera at them as if it were a magic wand, which would order them in the way Mario imagined. I developed the footage, and we watched it together. Mario seemed distracted. He had trouble getting his head around the notion that he had created those images. He walked over to the window. "Why is that?" I showed him how to use the zoom and focus and placed him in front of the upstairs window. I told him to find a frame he liked and to follow it wherever it might lead him. Then we took a subway ride, and as he looked through the lens, he said, I wondered what he could possibly mean, there being no snake nor any other creature in the window. But Mario continued to concentrate intensely on the snake, and seeing those images now, it seems he was right by his lights, such as they were. I often find myself looking at the material Mario captured during those years. He was excited by what he saw on the lens. It was not he, but neither was it anyone else. It was his choice to frame it as he wished. It was only he who thought to follow that snake wherever it might lead him. He sensed that there was an object he could concentrate on, and by that concentration bend it to his will. And if the world wanted to try to intervene by exerting itself in the background, then that was fine with Mario. He knew what he was looking at. He didn't need to see the film projected. He just needed to see it. That was enough to calm him. He saw it. He asked me if he could take the camera home. He wanted to show his father what he could do. But when we developed the film, we found it was hopelessly underexposed. I couldn't finish the film before I had to report to my new job, so on my last day at school, I decided to pretend the project had never existed. Though I returned to the school often to visit my class, no one ever asked me about it again. Nevertheless, I couldn't bring myself to start another project until I had finished my film for Group 10. I couldn't wait to see their faces when I surprised them with the finished film they had forgotten they had made. Some months later, I received a packet in the mail. Inside was a roll of 8mm film and a note.